Hello everyone! In today's video, we're going to go over the KutaSoftware Infinite Algebra 2 free worksheet, sample spaces, and the counting principle. I'll leave a link in the description below so you know how to access this free worksheet. Now, for the first set, it says to represent the sample space using set notation. So quickly, the sample space are the possible samples that we have, and set notation is just putting it within those curly or squiggly brackets. So let's dive into number one and go over that sample space. So reading number one, it says that a sandwich shop has three types of sandwiches: ham, turkey, and chicken. So if you went to go order a sandwich, you would have three different options or three different samples to choose from. So in set notation, start with a squiggly left bracket, and then we're going to write ham, then comma, our next sample is turkey, comma, our next sample is chicken. And then we'll go ahead and close that bracket. Let's move on to question number two. For question number two, it states that the chess club must decide when to meet for a practice. The possible days are Tuesday, Wednesday, or Thursday. So our different options, our different samples, are either Tuesday, Wednesday, or Thursday. And remember, using set notation, we're going to enclose those three different options within squiggly brackets or curly braces. Now, let's move on to question three. For question three, again, we're talking about the chess club. They must decide when to meet for practice. The possible days are Tuesday, Wednesday, or Thursday. So very similar to our previous question, except now we also have different times associated with those days. So the possible times are 3, 4, or 5 p.m. So in order to make this simple, I'm going to do some shorthand. I'm going to make Tuesday T, Wednesday will be W, Thursday I'll represent with an R. So what possible times can we meet on Tuesday? Well, Tuesday we can meet at 3, 4, or 5. So we can meet Tuesday at 3, and I'll enclose that in parentheses, that's one sample. We can meet Tuesday at 4, that's another sample, or Tuesday at 5. Three different times for the day. Now we'll move on to Wednesday. Same thing, we can meet Wednesday at 3 o'clock, we can meet Wednesday at 4 o'clock, or we can meet Wednesday at 5 o'clock. And then lastly, our Thursday. So we can meet Thursday again at 3, Thursday at 4, or Thursday at 5. So you can see, once I close this in my bracket, how many different samples do I have? Well, let's box our answer and count them up. We've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 different samples within this set using 3 possible days and 3 different times. Let's move on to number 4. In number 4, it says, when a button is pressed, a computer program outputs a random odd number that's greater than 1 and less than 9. You push the button twice. So key facts here, it's an odd number that's greater than 1 and less than 5. So what is that? Well, that would be either 3, 5, or 7. So our potential options are 3, 5, and 7. And if we push the button twice, we're getting 2 odd numbers. So when we push the button once, we can get any of these three numbers. And when we push it again, we can get any of the 3 same numbers. So we could push the button and get an odd number of 3. And we can push it again and get the same exact one. We can push it and get 3. Or we can push it a second time and get 5. We can push the button, get 3. Push the button again, get 7. Is there any other combinations we can make where we push and get 3 first? No. 3, 3, 3, 5, and 3, 7 are all the different possibilities of pushing 3 first. So what happens if we push 5 first? Well, if we push 5 first, the second button we can get is 3. If we push 5 first, we could also potentially get a 5. And if we push 5 first, we could also get a 7. So then there's 3 unique combinations where we're starting with a 5. And then lastly, we can push the button first and get a 7. And when we get a 7 and push the button a second time, there's 3 possible outcomes. Again, that's 3, 5, and 7. So we can push it once, get 7, push it again, and get 3. Push it once, get 7, push it again, get 5. And then lastly, 7 and 7. How many different combinations is that? Again, that's 9 different combinations. 3 for 3 first, 3 with 5 first, and 3 with 7 first. You could also think of it as 3 combinations getting 3 last, 3 combinations getting 5 last, 3 combinations getting 7 last, all of our different potentials. Let's move on to number 5. In number 5, it says that a spinner can land on either red or blue. You spin, and then you roll a 6-sided die. So this one's a bit trickier. We have 2 options for our first move, and then 6 different options for our second move. So let's start with spinning and landing on red. If we spin and land on the color red, which I'll use as R, well, when we roll a die, what are our possible options? We can get a 1, we can get a 2, 3, all the way up to 6. So our first potential is red and rolling a 1. Our second potential, spinning a red and rolling a 2. And we'll do this all the way up to the number 6. Red and 3, red and 4, red and 5, or red and 6. Now, we'll repeat those same exact steps, but for blue. We can spin blue and roll a 1. We can spin blue, roll a 2, and so on. Blue 3, blue and 4, blue and 5, blue and 6. And there is our sample space, the set of all possible outcomes. What could potentially happen? Now, moving on to number 6. There are 2 boys and a girl on a trivia team. 2 questions remain. 1 team member is randomly picked to answer the first question, and a keyword different member, so we can't use the same member, is picked to answer the second question. So we're going to write the possible options for this. So there's 2 boys and 1 girl, but the boys are different people. So we're going to name one boy as B1, the other boy as B2, and the girl can just be simply G. Or you could put it as G1. It doesn't matter. There's just 1 girl on this team. So we have 3 different options for the different people, and there's 2 questions. Question 1 and question 2. Who can answer each? So let's say that the first question is answered by the first boy, boy 1. Well, since he can't be picked again, we only have boy 2 or girl left, so we'll pick boy 2. And then if boy 1 starts us off again, well, then the girl is picked. So those are the different options when boy 1 answers the first question. What happens when boy 2 starts us off? Well, when boy 2 starts us off, we can either randomly pick boy 1 next or randomly pick girl next. So boy 1 can come after boy 2 or girl can come after boy 2. And then lastly, what happens if we randomly choose the girl first? Well, we have 2 options if the girl is first. We have choosing boy 1 next or the girl, and then getting boy 2 next. The different combinations of people for answering 2 separate questions. There is our sample space. And again, the keyword here was different members. If not, we could have boy 1, boy 1, boy 2, boy 2, and girl, girl. We could potentially have 3 more if they didn't have to be different members, but it's stated that they did, so we only have 6 options. Let's move on to our next set of directions. Our next set of directions say to find the number of possible outcomes in the sample space. And to be honest with you, that's what we've already been doing. It's just counting the number of outcomes, counting the different options in our set. So let's create a set and then count it. It says a jewelry store sells gold and platinum rings. So we know we have two different types of rings, gold or platinum, G or P, and each ring is fitted with either a ruby, sapphire, emerald, or a diamond gemstone. So two different ring types and four different stone options. So let's go ahead and build our set. We can have a gold ring, G, with a ruby stone. We can have a gold ring with a sapphire stone. We can have a gold ring with an emerald stone, or we could have a gold ring with a diamond stone. Same type of ring, four different stones. Now let's move on to our next ring, a platinum ring with a ruby stone. We could do a platinum ring with a sapphire stone. We can do a platinum ring with an emerald stone, or we can do a platinum ring with a diamond stone. Now that we have all of our different outcomes, let's just count them up. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 8 different possible rings. So notice here, an easier way to do this would have been to recognize if we have two different rings, each with four different options, two rings with four options each, 2 times 4 equals 8. Let's move on to number 8. In number 8, it says can land on either red, blue, or green, and we spin twice. So think about this before we even write out our sample space. If we have three different colors that we can get for our first spin and three different options we can get for our second spin, the number of outcomes is 9. So 9 should be our solution. And let's double check that. If we spin red first, we can spin red again. If we spin red first, we can spin blue. And if we spin red, we can spin green. Now, the next color first. If we spin blue first, we can spin red next. If we spin blue first, we can spin blue next. And then blue again, and followed by green. Finishing off our last color, we'll have G, R, G, B, and then G, G. How many is that? 3, 6, 9 different options. So 9 is indeed our answer. Let's move on to number 9. In number 9, it says 8 rooms in a house need to be painted. Each room can be painted white or yellow. So this one is a little bit trickier than both 7 and 8 because there's 8 different rooms, but each room is a unique room. So we could have room 1, room 2, room 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, or 8. We can paint them all white. That's one option. We can paint them all yellow. That's another option. We can paint room 1 white and the rest yellow. We can paint room 1 and 2 white and the rest yellow. And we can paint room 1 and room 3 white and the rest yellow, and so on. So you can see there's tons of different combinations we can do. But here's a simple quick trick. If we have 8 unique rooms, each can either be white or yellow. That's the 2 different colors raised to the number of different rooms. 2 to the 8th. And 2 to the 8th is going to give us 256. So there's 256 different options. So writing out this sample space would have taken us a long time. And if you're confused on how I got 256, think about this. We have 8 unique rooms that could be a kitchen, a bathroom, a laundry room, a bedroom, any kind of room, right? But they're all very unique rooms. So if I just paint 3 rooms white, well, I can paint different combinations of 3 rooms white. I can paint 3 bedrooms white, or I can paint a kitchen, the bathroom, and the laundry white and paint the rest yellow. So the type of room matters. That's why we raise it to the power of 8, because it's unique rooms. So if I have two different options to paint each room, I have 8 rooms. So let's draw 8 blanks. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So kitchen, bathroom, laundry, bedroom, etc. Each has 2 different color options, right? So 2 different color choices for the kitchen, 2 for the bathroom, 2 for the next room, and so on. Well, all you need to do is multiply each of those together. 2 times 2 times 2 times 2 times 2, and so on. That's 2 to the 8th, or our 256. So remembering this, let's move on to number 10. For number 10, it states that 6 books need to be placed on a shelf. You randomly arrange the books on the shelf from left to right. So we have 6 different potential slots. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And the 6 different books are unique books. We can have a book about colors, a book about math, rainbows, food, etc. They're all unique books. So if I put a book about rainbows at the start and then the book about statistics and then the book about food, I could switch this order up and it would be a completely different ordering. So we need to keep that in mind. So think about this. How many books could I potentially put in this first slot? Well, since I haven't assigned any, I could put 6 different books here. And depending on what book I put here, how many books can I put in this remaining slot? Well, 5 different books I have to choose from. How about in this next slot? That's 4 different books. In the next slot, if I've already have 3 books placed, I only have 3 more books. And then there's only 2 books left. And then finally, when I got down to here, there's only 1 book left I can place. What we're going to do is multiply these numbers together. 6 times 5 times 4 times 3 times 2 times 1 will give us all the different outcomes of putting books in a specific order from left to right. So multiplying this out, 6 times 5 is 30. 30 times 4 is 120. 120 times 3 is 360. And 360 times 2 is 720, multiplied by 1, and you get 720. So there's 720 different ways to arrange 6 books. And with that, we wrap up this free CUDA software website worksheet. If you have any questions, please leave them in the comments below. And as always, don't forget to like, subscribe, and share.